In part, some reflections on the problems that academics have interacting with the scientific literature in particular, but the literature generally. So some personal reflections, and then a demonstration of a tool that we've built recently that tries to bring together the literature with the data behind the literature. I've changed the title slightly from what was in the program, but the content of the talk is pretty much the same. This is not a hamburger. So René Magritte's famous pipe. This is not a pipe, so seen as time peep. So what was all this about? What did he mean when he painted this picture? When he was challenged about it, this is what he said. The famous pipe, how people reproached me for it. And yet, could you stuff my pipe? No, it's just a representation, is it not? So if I had written on my picture, this is a pipe, I'd have been lying. And I'm just going to leave this idea hanging in the air for a moment and continue with some other stuff, but I'll come back to it and hopefully explain why this is relevant to the talk a little bit later on. So I've probably been talking for about a minute or so. So whilst I've been talking, something in the region of this number of papers have appeared in the scientific literature since I've been standing here. So in PubMed, in the life sciences alone, there are two papers a minute or something like that. And by the time I've finished talking, there will be an astonishing amount of new literature available for life scientists to try and get their head around. So two papers a minute is an overwhelming amount of information for a human to try and consume. So it's fairly clear that we need some kind of support from machines in order to be able to deal with the deluge of information that scientists now have to concern themselves about. So, of course, not every paper here is going to be relevant to every researcher in the life sciences. This is across a whole enormous field. But talking to one of my colleagues in Manchester, who's he's an epidemiologist and he does a lot of reviewing, he reckons that there are something in the region of 6,000 papers a month that are relevant to him that he would like to know about, even if it's just to discount their relevance. So in doing sort of systematic reviewing, and it's impossible for him to, you can't read that amount of stuff as a human. So we definitely need some kind of computational support for this. And I'm just going to read through this quote from Amos Baerup, one of these preeminent bioinformaticians of our time. It's quite depressive to think that we are spending millions in grants for people to perform experiments, produce new knowledge, hide this knowledge in often badly written text, and then spend some more millions trying to second guess what the authors really did and found. And for most of us, this is a daily experience of having to rummage through human-created text in order to find out what we know. So knowing what we know is actually quite hard. So where is the problem? What's the cause of this problem? So one of the interesting phenomena that is worth thinking about is that, does this problem exist in all areas of life? Because the web seems to have solved a lot of this in some ways. So I make a thing, you find a thing, and you've got a thing. I mean, okay, if it's the web, it's almost certainly a picture of a cat or a video of a cat doing something cute. But it's the web seems quite good at transmitting ideas very rapidly around the world. And so why doesn't this work for science? What's the fundamental thing that makes this different for science? I mean, the process that we have, the relationship between academics and publishers is a bit more complicated. I make a thing, I send a thing to a publisher, the publisher gets some people to look at the thing, people don't completely like the thing, I change my thing, now some people like my thing, publisher makes the thing a bit nicer to look at and puts it in a special place, and then you can find. So the whole process is significantly more complicated, and then you can read it, than it is when you're just posting a video of a cat doing a cute dance. And probably for a good reason. So this is a way of characterizing the situation as I see it. So publish or perish is a phrase that's been around for quite a long time, but I'd like to introduce the idea of the prisoner's dilemma, which is an idea from game theory. So the idea of the prisoner's dilemma is that two people have been caught performing something nefarious, and they are put in separate rooms and spoken to independently, and they are offered an opportunity to either reduce their sentence or increase their sentence, depending on how they choose to act. So if one person chooses to blame the other person, then that person will be convicted. If both players decide to confess, then there's a bad outcome. If both players decide to act silently, then there's a reasonably good outcome that the sentence is lowered. But if one person cheats the system and decides to blame the other person entirely, they get away free and the other person gets the complete sentence. And so the game theory here is, what do you do? You can't communicate with the other person. Are they going to cooperate and you're going to sort of share the sentence at a lower level? Or are you going to cheat on your partner and try and get them to take the whole of the blame? And this sort of characterizes the situation we're in as academics in the current publishing environment, because there are lots of fantastic ideas as to how I could publish my research that don't involve going through standard publishing mechanisms. I could just write about it on a blog. And if the whole world decided to do that simultaneously, then the current publishing model would essentially collapse. But if one person cheats and decides, actually, I'm not going to write it on my blog, I'm going to go to Nature, chances are they will get published because there are fewer people competing in that field. Okay, so that's an enormous simplification of it. But in order to break the current cycle or the current relationship between academics and publishers, it kind of needs everybody to act in concert. Otherwise, the people who stay with the old system benefit at the expense of people who are trying to do something innovative. So who are the players in this? Well, we've got the scientist, the academic, doing we are sort of locked into the system because our careers rely on being published in high-impact journals and being cited and that kind of stuff. If I pull out of this system, then I will stop getting funding and I will stop being a scientist. So I fall out of the system very quickly if I decide not to play by the current rules. And then there's the funding bodies. Well, how do they decide who to give the money to? Well, they have to use the same kind of metrics of citation and stuff like that, because they are also accountable to whoever it is that gives them the money, whether it's a national government or a charity or whatever. So they need reliable, robust metrics that they can fall back to say, okay, well, this project didn't go quite as well. We funded it a lot of money. It didn't go as we expected. But look, it was a good gamble because all of these objective measures told us that this was a good place to put the money. So the system works in a sort of self-contained way, in a sort of slightly self-referential way, and it does work. And the role of publishers essentially seems to be to make that system work. It's a service to both the authors and the readers. I mean, and obviously the readers are massively important here, and as well to the funding bodies as a mechanism of giving authoritative metrics to the community. It just, a phrase from computer science that I thought might be an interesting one to just let float by here, which is the idea of deadly embrace. And this is where two processes in a computing system have grabbed hold of one another in such a way that neither of them can operate further. So they've become entangled in a way that nothing sensible can happen to the system later. And it actually comes from, I think, from Rescue at Sea, where somebody's trying to rescue somebody who grabs onto them and both of them sink. Moving on. The other thing that gets the blame for the sort of the locked-inness of the current situation, and the fact that there is this overwhelm of information that scientists can't possibly cope with, is the PDF format. PDF, electronic paper, essentially, a format in which you can put text and pictures, and it sort of sits there as a little blob in the web that's somehow separated out from the rest. It's not very semantic, it's not connected in quite the same way that wikis and blogs are to the rest of the evolving infrastructure. And so it comes in for a lot of stick as being the core cause of the overwhelm of information that scientists have to deal with. So here are some of the things that have been said against PDFs over recent years. And it's an insult to science. It's antithetical to the spirit of the web. It's like inventing the telephone and then using it to transmit Morse code. And my favorite, and the one that inspired the name of this talk, is a hamburger that we're trying to turn back into a cow, which we've heard before. And you can see where this comes from, because actually pulling apart the information in a PDF is actually quite hard. And yet, over 80% of scientists just consume PDFs. They just download the PDF, they stick it on the hard drive, and then they've got it. And there are lots of nice things about the PDF. It has edges. Unlike the web, where you can sort of sprawl in all directions, It's a self-contained little blob of information, and sometimes that's exactly what you need. But at the same time, those edges impose limitations. But the problem, I say, is not the PDF. It's something more fundamental, and it looks like this. On one hand, we have computers, and on the other hand, we have humans. So a human comes along and says, I've got some things, and I need them to be ordered according to their size, smallest first, biggest last. So this is, you know, the simplest kind of scientific problem that I can think of. And so I don't know how many of you speak fluent first-order predicate logic, but this is about the most straightforward representation that I could think of it that is potentially meaningful to a machine. So this says, for all things I and J that exist in the domain of S, it's true that for I being less than or equal to J implies that the ith element of S is less than or equal to the jth element of S, which is first-order logic representation of I've got a set of things and they're ordered smallest, first, biggest, last. Okay, so a massive gulf between essentially the simplest representation that I can think of that would make any sense to a machine and what a human actually meant. Of course, really, to get the machine to do this, we've got to go a step further than this and write an algorithm. So here's a bit of Python code to implement what I've just talked about. And that's miles away from anything that any normal human will be able to describe. So the problem is that it's not the PDF, it's not necessarily the relationship between academics and publishers, it's not HTML, it's the fact that humans and machines speak very, very different languages, and we are now creating more information than ever before, and we need machines to support us in understanding it. So, Mr. Tiddles was resting in the cozy cat bag. Okay, so this is, yeah, bear with me. This is a bit of plain English that's a representation of the cat sat on the mat. Okay, so again, pretty much the simplest thing that I could think of to say in English. And actually, it's plausible that a machine would be able to interpret that sentence. With a bit of natural language processing, you'd build a parse tree like this with nouns and verbs and predicates and that kind of stuff. So potentially with the right identifiers and the right mappings, a machine would just about, on a good day, be able to make sense of the cat sat on the mat, maybe. But we don't write that in scientific papers very, very often. So here's an example, admittedly at the other extreme. So this is perfectly valid, meaningful English. Buffalo, 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 buffalo. Okay, this is meaningful, syntactically and grammatically correct English. To understand this, you need to know that buffalo is a place, just on the border between the States and Canada. It's also one of them things. And it's also a verb which means to bully or to harass. So buffalo, 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 buffalo. Or if I swap some of the words around, it means, if I replace the animal with bison, just to make it a bit clearer, buffalo bison, whom buffalo bison bully, also bully buffalo bison. Yeah, so that's, and so, you know, it's not the most profound insight into the nature of bison, but it is perfectly grammatically meaningful. A computer would have no chance of making any sense of that. So the question that we have to think about is, when we write scientific discourse, are we writing at the level of the cat sat on the mat, or are we writing at the level of buffalo, buffalo, buffalo? You know, which to a machine is it more like? And I think the answer lies somewhere between the two, that probably in your methods section of a scientific paper, you're saying sort of, you know, I put this thing in here and then took 3 milliliters of that and cooked it at 5 degrees and blah, 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 in a fairly sort of mechanical kind of way. But when you get to the results and the conclusions, you're hedging your terminology, you're saying things in a much more complex way, you're introducing sophisticated abstract concepts. Difficult. And that's probably the really interesting bit for most people. You know, this is kind of just a recipe if you want to reproduce something. So I thought I'd have a look at a few important scientific papers and see what they actually look like. So here we have the amide groups of insulin, a paper by Fred Sanger, which was very important in its time. And it sort of goes like, it sort of goes blah, 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 blah. And then it goes, on the next page, it goes blah, 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 for quite a long time, blah, 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 da, 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 da. And then the small stuff and go da, 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 da. A bit more da, 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 and then it stops. And And so the question is, why was this paper so important? And if we look down here, that's why this paper is important. The results are summarised in Table 7. And Table 7, and this was profound. The information encapsulated in that picture was, you know, not world-changing, but massively important in its field. Completely, completely opaque to machines. You know, even if this wasn't a scanned image, there's no algorithm that would be able to work out what Dr. Sanger was talking about. So, at the other extreme, this is a paper published by a colleague at the University of Manchester a few years ago. The schemes of flux of control in a model of Saccharomyces cerevisiae glycolysis. Fascinating stuff if you're in that area. And I'm sure Doug would be happy for me to say that this paper also kind of goes blah, 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 quite a lot. And again, the information that really matters was in that diagram on the right, which is this picture here. But they went to the effort of encoding that diagram, which was the sort of the key discovery or the key message for their paper, in something that was meaningful to the machine. But just encoding the information regarding that one line, that one entry in this graph of all these relationships takes this amount of stuff, which they had to do manually. So that's RDF written by hand about one entry in a diagram that actually has, you know, 30 or so objects and twice as many relationships between. So it's an enormous undertaking to make that information accessible to the machine. Just one more example. Molecular structure of nucleic acids. So should be a fairly well-known paper, this one, the Watson and Crick discovery of the structure of DNA. And once again, the information here is primarily encoded in this diagram here. This is what they discovered. It's in that picture there. And the phrase says, this structure has two helical chains, each coiled around the same axis, see diagram. There are a couple of other brilliant statements in this article, which kind of become brilliant in hindsight. This structure has novel features, which are of considerable biological interest. And I think my favorite understatement that I've ever seen. It has not escaped our notice that the specific pairing we have postulated immediately suggests a possible copying mechanism for genetic material. Yeah? But a machine would never understand what that meant. Yeah? That's so hedged and so sort of elegantly written that no chance for a machine to understand what that actually meant. So that's quite scary. So I guess the point of this part of the talk so far is that it's not the technology, it's not the mechanism, it's the fact that humans and machines speak very different languages, which is making the job particularly hard at the moment. And managing the representation of, doesn't matter whether it's a PDF, doesn't matter whether it's HTML, that's the real challenge. So this is not the hamburger, the PDF is not the hamburger, it's the fact that we think in different ways to machines that makes our job difficult. So do we go for a revolutionary approach where everything changes overnight, or an evolutionary approach? Revolution, extremely difficult. So I'll show you a couple of videos of a tool that we've built to try and take an evolutionary step towards something which brings together what machines and humans understand. So this is a video of Utopia Documents, which is a PDF reader, essentially. So start the PDF reader up and drop into it a standard PDF. And there is nothing special about the PDF that's being dropped into here. It's just a normal PDF, could be any PDF. So the first thing that you'll notice is down here at the bottom, the thumbnails of the various different pages, some of them have got these little red dog ears on the corners. They're a little bit bleached out in this video, but they've got little triangles on the corner, which means Utopia has done something to that page as it was loading it in and analyzing the contents of that page of the PDF. Now, in this case, here's a table of information. Now, that would be quite difficult if I wanted to analyze that. I would have to cut and paste it into some kind of spreadsheet. With Utopia, you can get at the information in that table and treat it as a live spreadsheet. So just go in, get hold of the figures. So here we turn them into a little graph, for example. Or you could export them to to a proper sort of heavy-duty analysis package, or in this case, just change the axes that are being displayed. So that makes getting at that particular kind of information from within the PDF considerably more straightforward than it would be otherwise. So I mentioned that figures and diagrams play an important part in the structure of scientific discourse. So Utopia will extract the images that are shown in an article so that you can flip through them straightforwardly. When you double-click on it, it'll take you to the page that's got that image in it. And in this case, it's a three-dimensional protein, which has been annotated with its three-dimensional structure. So here, Utopia has gone to the protein data bank and downloaded the correct backbone structure for that particular protein so that you can explore it in three dimensions. And you'll see that here on the left, this little bubble here, means that some kind of discussion has been started about that region of the paper. So this is something that happens in real time. It's not embedded in the PDF. It's overlaid dynamically on the PDF. And this thread of discussion here is about some colleagues and I talking to the author of this paper to work out which molecule he had actually meant in that particular diagram there. One more little example. This is a plugin to Utopia, which was written by some of our colleagues in the Netherlands, who have an interest in a particular kind of three-dimensional structure of a particular kind of protein called the G-protein coupled receptor. And in the literature, these G-protein coupled receptors are described in a number of different ways using a number of different coordinate systems to refer to the different amino acids within the structure of the protein. And that makes it quite fiddly if it's not using your favorite way of talking about a protein. So what they developed is a text mining plugin for Utopia, which analyzes the content of the article, and in a very domain-specific way. So it's highly precise, but wouldn't work for an article about cats. And it will find terms in the article that are relevant to that particular kind of protein and do a translation between the different coordinate systems on the fly for you. So those are the regions where it's found terms that are relevant. And if you then click on those, it'll go directly to their database and bring back information about that very specific, highly precise piece of protein information. So it's, in this case, it's the adenosine receptor. And similarly, if I go to so the tryptophan residue there, it brings back information about it and even renders and places that specific residue, which is mentioned for that particular species in that particular paper, in the context of a three-dimensional representation of the GPCR. So that's a very useful way of augmenting the structure of a scientific article. Here I've activated a plugin called Reflect, which uses code written at the EMBL. This normally applies to web pages, but here we can now bring that text mining information directly into the PDF so that you can point at a phrase and bring back information about that particular object. Last thing I'd like to show you is a project that we've been doing with Elsevier recently, which is to use the information that's in Science Direct to be applied retrospectively to PDFs that have been published in the past. So one of the bugbears of reading a PDF is the fact that when you're chasing through the references, you're having to deal with the fact that quite often they're just written as things in square brackets, but at best you'll just get the first name of the author to which that reference is relevant. And then you have to flip to the back in order to work out whether you like that, you know, whether you want to chase that up. So what we can do here is match the references to the information that's in Science Direct so that when you click on a reference, it tells you what that paper is, gives you the authors and the title, and in the latest version also the abstract, so you can see whether that's a paper you want to chase. And then to make the job even easier, you can just, if you have the correct authority, the correct license to get that article, you simply select that option from the menu and it will go to Science Direct, fetch the article and open it up in Utopia documents for you. So you can chase from one reference to another very, very straightforwardly. So these are the team back in Manchester who have been building Utopia documents, and these are the people and organizations that have supported it. This was a project that was originally put together by Portland Press, to whom we owe an enormous debt of gratitude for getting this off the ground. So I'll leave it there. If you take any questions, thank you.
On Twitter, people say this was also the funniest presentation so far. But I could feel that people also were very interested in it. I'm sure there will be questions. In the back, Kari.
Sorry, no, the furthest distance from the microphone. Thank you for an inspiring talk, really interesting. But is it, you're going into the PDF in a sense, structured information that's been, in a sense, destructured and then trying to get the structure. Isn't it better just to forget PDF and go to a, well, anything else really?
Absolutely, and when the rest of the world goes along with it, then the problem will be solved. I guess the problem is that there's a massive legacy of PDF documents. Even if tomorrow we switch over to, you know, the brand new thing that doesn't quite exist yet, there are millions of them that somehow we have to deal with. And it'd be brilliant if people marked things up in advance, but not, they don't yet. So this is, I guess we're trying to provide a stepping stone from where we are now to where we'd like to be, rather than just saying, you know, it can't be done.
Sorry, just if I got the mic. Quick follow-up. Would tagged PDF, are these any, would a tagged PDF help Utopia?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, if publishers put the correct metadata and used PDFs in the way that they are designed to be used, that would make our life a lot easier. And I think readers' lives a lot easier. But sadly, the majority of PDFs have nonsense metadata inside them.
Okay, thank you very much. For the sake of time, I'd like to move on, but I thank you very, very much for a wonderful talk. Okay, can we... Yeah.